So let me introduce the founding father of modern quantum optics, Anton Zeilinger. Okay, please, you have 50 minutes for the lecture.
So thank you very much. I'm very glad to be again in Russia, even as this is only virtual. And I have my definite plans to come to Russia and visit you people in person as soon as this is possible. Yes, I will mention a little bit later. I should apologize myself that this has been delayed, but I'm getting some health checkups in the hospital now, and you know how it is. They put some tests and so on, and this can be changed in the last minute and so on. So I apologize for being late. Now I choose the title from quantum particles to quantum information. I've been told that there are a number of participants who are not so familiar with the developments. So I just want to go into some details about how this all happened and some interesting last results, recent results. I have a question. Is this being recorded? Is this talk being recorded? Hello? Can you hear me? I cannot hear you.
Yes, it is recorded.
Oh, good. Okay. Mm-hmm. And is it put on the internet somewhere?
Yeah. But if you don't want it, we will completely remove it.
No, probably not. I mean, the problem with putting on internet is whether you really mention everyone, you know, who contributed to the field.
Yeah. Okay.
And the topic is so huge that I apologize now already that if someone is not mentioned, please let me know if someone who watches this later is not mentioned, I will immediately change that. So now what you see here is the Canary Island of Tenerife. You know, this is off the west coast of Africa. It belongs to Spain. And it's actually, what you see here is a telescope on the islands of Tenerife and also on the island of La Palma, of which you heard recently in the news because of this volcano. There are telescopes, on each one about a dozen. So 10 to 12 telescopes. And if you ever can visit the area, do it. This is an absolutely fantastic location for top science. Now, the telescope you see here is the OGS, Optical Ground Station. It's operated by the European Space Agency. It was built for testing classical communication with satellites, because evidently light has a much broader bandwidth than radio waves. What we use it at first for testing local communication from Tenerife over to La Palma. You see here this is just a guiding laser beam. So the telescopes find each other, the sending and the receiving telescopes, which is at the right hand. And then we used it also for the communication with the Chinese satellite missions. Now, just to set the stage, I know you all know this, but it never hurts to remember that. We have in 1900 the beginning of quantum physics, initially with Planck and with Einstein. Then it took 20 years to build a full theory, which is quite interesting. And you all know why. And then already in the 30s, the discussion about interpretations started. This discussion has not stopped today yet, even as many people think that their personal interpretation is the final one. This is probably not the case. Probably we are lacking some radical ideas to really find out why we do have quantum physics from a conceptual point of view. The agreement with, one point, the agreement with experiment and the beauty of the theory. I mean, there have been very famous Russian contributions to the development. I just remember Prokhintsev, for example, and many others. The mathematical beauty is immense. To me, this is the most beautiful theory we ever invented. So it is probably, it is true. This is a good reason for being true. And it agrees with the experiment. But why do we have it, besides explaining experiments? This is interesting and open. Now, the surprise was in 1970, we start with fundamental experiments in various fields where we were able to when I use we, I often mean the worldwide physics community, where we do experiments with individual particles. I just remember the pioneering experiments of Letokov on cooling individual atoms, for example. This is a good example. It was a little bit later in the 1970s, but he was the first to do that. And in the 1990s, to the surprise of everyone, you know, we did not expect that the early experiments lead to any new technology. And suddenly people started to talk about quantum computers, you know, quantum communication, quantum teleportation, and all this. And this slide I wrote a couple of years ago, predicting that in 2020, we have the beginning of the age of the quantum internet. And this happens, you know, China is, in my eyes, ahead in all this by having worldwide quantum communication. Just to say one point about Einstein, in his famous paper in 1905, which every physicist learns as explaining the photoelectric effect. In reality, this is only a side result. In reality, Einstein found out that the entropy of an ideal gas varies in the same way as a function of volume as the entropy of a radiation field inside a holoraum, inside a enclosement. And therefore, he says, I suggest that light also consists of particles. This is very interesting. And he realized immediately that the things are very, very strange, and said that he wants to spend the rest of his life thinking about the question, what light is. It's a good point, you know, what light is. And not just, you know, mathematical solution or something. A very good point for every quantum physicist is that, you know, Einstein got his Nobel Prize for this. And this is the only paper he called very revolutionary. Here's something which tells you that the time, by the time, so to speak, was, this is 1913. Einstein was suggested for election to the Prussian Academy of Science in Berlin. And four people, Planck, Ernst, Rubens, and Warburg, three of those received the Nobel Prize, said that he should be elected because he's such a great scientist, but it should not be held against him that, for example, with his hypothesis of light quanta, he went too far. He was too courageous, because without the risk, and not even in the exactest sciences, you can introduce something new. This was 1913. And just to you all and to the young people, you know, it is a fantastic feature of science, it's a fantastic feature of physics, that in 1913, some famous people can say, oh, this is nonsense. And in 1921, he gets the Nobel Prize for this. This change in the face of evidence is the strength of science in all fields. To me, the field of quantum information started in 1970 with, maybe you know that, but I just want to mention this, with Stephen Wiesner having the idea of uncopyable quantum money, where the number of the banknote is printed in quantum bits, in qubits. And this original idea already contains the concept of no cloning. It contains randomness of the individual result, unless you mention in an eigenbasis. It contains complementarity of mutually unbiased bases. So these are the only fundamental concept it does not contain is entanglement yet. Here my simple way to explain to newcomers what a case of a qubit. You take a semi-reflective mirror, you have a source of single photons here, And you have the single photon can either be reflected or transmitted. When it detects, is detected here, we call it zero, here we call it one. And the important point is that we talk about the superposition. So until we do the measurement, it is absolutely undecided. It's objectively undecided what will result. So it is wrong to think that quantum states have to have their properties like this one before the measurement is done. Now the problem is that how to explain that, for example, in a simple case here the zero happens, in another case here the one. This is the quantum measurement problem to explain why specific events happen, and this cannot be in any way explained by standard quantum mechanics. So it goes beyond physics, the linear idea of quantum physics. All the idea of decoherence and so on do not solve this problem, because they only can explain why zero and one are not coherent to each other, but they cannot explain why a specific event happens. Now, I have some ideas about that. I will mention this in the end. But I think this cannot be solved. This is the famous qubit. And this is objective randomness, not explainable by any hidden thing. Danke. So sorry, I'm in the hospital, I just had to ask. They come a little bit later. What did I want to say? Yeah, I forgot it. Here's Einstein. In the letter of 14 December 1926 from Einstein to Max Born, everybody should read. He is convinced that God does not play dice with the universe. So in other words, he's convinced that objective randomness does not exist. We believe today that in that position Einstein was certainly wrong. Now, as I said, the only concept which was not contained was entanglement, which goes back to this Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paper in 1935. Actually, it turns out that there were others worrying about entanglement before, but not published, like Erwin Schrödinger. He had worked on since about 1935. And the point is that you have two systems which interacted in the past, and they then can be only described by joint state without having individual properties. Here is the citations of the Einstein-Podolsky paper until truth. Oh, this is an old version. I have newer one, but it doesn't matter. The paper was basically ignored. 1970 it starts for fundamental reasons, and in 2000 it explodes because entanglement is a fundamental concept in quantum information, as you know, and there were some talks about this already and so on and so on. I just want to focus on the essential point. We have a source which produces here entangled photons in a superposition state, as it is written here, HV minus VH. And what this means that if you measure one photon, it's H, you know definitely the other one is V, and vice versa. But these properties are not carried by the system before they are measured. And Einstein argued in his autobiographical notes, since the results are definite, you know, when you measure one, you definitely know what the other side gives. If you measure the same basis, physics cannot describe the real factual situation. This is correct if you mean by facts all individual events. This is just Bell's theorem. I don't want to go into details here how some sources look like. The source built by Paul Kwiat in my group is Sergienko and others. So we have a nonlinear crystal which produces pairs of photons. I mentioned here that in Moscow at that time we had a school of David Klitschko, whom I met a couple of times, who made very important contributions to the concept theory of entanglement and also to practical implications. Now I want to come to one point which I find actually one of the most interesting ones. Not everybody shares this viewpoint, but that's how physics is. You create a source of entangled particles in a test of quantum entanglement, and you measure some property here, A and B, And the setting which you choose, for example, the orientation of a polarizer or you name it, is chosen by this small knob A and B. And the point now is who decides what is being measured here? You know, if this is some classical information, it can all be, if it's so in sinusoidal, for example, what it can all be predicted. It is not really random. So there could be a joint cause which explains the joint results. And this is logically possible. I know it's outside physics, but it's an interesting question. So the standard solution is now in the lab to use quantum random number generators in some sort. But that is again a logic problem, maybe, because you test quantum mechanics using quantum mechanics. So the question is you want independent sources for the randomness, which are as independent as possible. So there have to be some very early events which have no common past. Here is the experiment which we did a while ago. It's not so long ago, 2018. So we have we use light from very distant sources using two very significant telescopes in the 4 meter class, the William Herschel telescope and the Telescopio Nazionale Galileo, the national Italian telescope on the island of La Palma. They look at different quasars, at quasar photons, which are billions of light years away. And so, you know, distance, their signals could not have been kind of overlapped or something. Now, the point is that what we use from these quasars is we have a color detector, which decides randomly whether the light coming from the quasar has more white or more blue. And if it's white, we choose one measurement basis. If it's blue, we choose the other measurement basis. And we do this completely independent on the other side. We choose different bases to choose the measurement. Now the source creates the pairs, sends them about half a kilometer to one side and to the other side. And what is important, this detector and the basis setting generator operate so fast that no signal from here has enough time to influence the other side, and vice versa, no signal from here can influence the other side. Now, this was a huge experiment, actually, with many participants, as you can see here, on the Canary Islands. And it took the measurement itself, it doesn't take very long, as soon as you have the quasar in focus. Here again is the setup. I explained it already in principle. You have the two telescopes to the left and the right, and they create number generators using color filters, CRNG and so on, cosmic random number generator, we call it, and they trigger an electro-optical modulators, EOM, right and left, and below you see the entangled photon source, where the two photons are sent to two measurement stations. Here's a picture of TNG, the Galileo telescope. Here's the receiving station for the entangled photons standing here. And the signal the measurement is done very fast, and the signal about the color comes from inside. I think this I can pass. This is a picture again of the light. The yellow signifies the light coming from the telescopes, and red and blue the two beams to the triggers defining what polarization is being measured. Here is basically the same, and what you can see here is the telescopes which were used. There were the quasars. One of them. This 12.21 is the farthest away bright object on the sky. We 12.2 light years, a billion light years away. This is 8 light years, this is 3 billion light years. And in all cases, we received significant violations of Bell's inequality. The limit is 2. Now, the point is, how can you go further? And this is something we are pursuing now. Evidently, one is to use light from the microwave background, the 3 Kelvin background radiation. This brings us back to about 380,000 years, I think, after the Big Bang. And after that, before that, the cosmos was not transparent. So you have to use another kind of radiation, and there are two kinds of radiation which come to mind. One is to look for primordial neutrinos which came from the Big Bang, and the other one is to look for primordial gravitational waves. Now the second choice with gravitational waves is very far out probably, but neutrinos is not completely impossible. So we can look into this kind of thing. Now I look at the time, how much I have used, 10:46. So how much more time do I have?
I think you have 25 minutes more.
25 minutes more. Okay, so I want to be fast now. This is maybe not so important. Multiphoton entanglement, you know, you've heard of this GHZ states, where you have qubits, more than at least 3 qubits or more entangled. And the point is, if you you get a contradiction between classical physics and quantum physics for individual events. It's not random anymore. I can browse all through, go through all this, I go through this. This is maybe not so important. Here's an interesting experiment just to tell you how fast the field developed. This was a single slit interference experiment we did with very cold neutrons in 1988. This is a while ago. At that time, it was the first experiment where a precision experiment of a double slit interference was performed. You see here neutrons, the distribution of the neutrons on the solid line is first principles quantum theory, which also allows you to test the Schrödinger equation, the linearity of the Schrödinger equation. So this puts extremely low limits on the non-linearity of Schrödinger equation, which to my knowledge have not been improved since then, because neutrons have many advantages. The important point is that the intensities here are so that when one neutron is measured, the next one, which will be measured, is still sitting in its uranium nucleus waiting for fission to happen. So this is individual to individual. And now why do I tell you this? Because in 1988, when I gave the talks about this, even famous professors came up and says, it really works, a single particle and so on. And I told them, you know, what do you expect? This is now common understanding, and we all work with these individual systems. But at that time, it was not common understanding. I just want to skip this here because this goes too far. Here's, to me, it's the most interesting effect of all this entanglement discussions, the fundamental effects, it's entanglement swapping. You create two entangled pairs here. So I talk only about the fundamental issue here. Two entangled pairs, okay, one and two, and three and four. And you subject them to what's called a Bell state measurement. So that means this measurement projects two and three onto an entangled state. Okay, fine. Now, which entangles one and four. So that way, one and four are becoming entangled. I mean, the mathematics is straightforward. I don't show it here. One and four becoming entangled, even as they share no common past at all. This in itself is interesting. And it's also interesting if you consider that when you now do the measurements, these are measurements individually are completely random. There is no hidden cause whatsoever. It can also be seen as a quantum teleporter of entangled state. This state is teleported over here, or this state is teleported over here. You can see it whichever way you want. And to the big surprise, this kind of scheme has become important we talk about the applications, future quantum repeaters, and so on. Here is an interesting fundamental idea which I want to go into details. The idea was by Asher Peres in 2001. Asher was one of the leading Israeli physicists in quantum foundations, and unfortunately, he passed away not much after that time. And he suggests the following. He suggests the delayed choice entanglements. He says, okay, we have two sources where each one creates entangled pairs. And here we do on 1 and 4, we do the measurement immediately. Like, you know, entanglement, polarization, for example. And if you randomly choose a linear and circular polarization, so the result is right-handed, vertical, right-handed, horizontal, minus the superposition of horizontal and vertical under 45 degrees, and so on. So you get completely random results here and on the other side. And then a third player, Victor, decides randomly whether he projects these two photons onto individual polarization measurements, so he gets, for example, that both are horizontal. They could also be one could horizontal vertical. Or when he projects them onto an entangled state, they can be one of the four Bell states. And this is also random. And the consequence is that if these two are individually measured, then the measurement results you can pick out, which are correlated with this result, indicate that the two are not entangled. When you project them in the middle on an entangled state, then they indicate that the two are entangled. So entanglement of some system depends, but we can talk about it, depends on the measurement performed later, after the signal has been classically recorded. Oh, this is the entangled state, actually, but it's not important here. Now, we did such an experiment a while ago. Jenewein did it statically, and Shansong Ma, who is now in China, a professor, it was his PhD thesis, so we have two entangled photon sources, and here we have an interferometer. We have an interferometer where these two photons are sent in, and you can set the internal phase of the interferometer such that the outcoming beams here are superpositions of this and this, or such that this input corresponds one-to-one to this, this input corresponds one-to-one to this. So the first one is projection of an entangled state, and the other one is individual measurements. Here are the details. I think that I should go into the technical details. And the point is, now you look at correlations of these photons here between horizontal, vertical, right-left polarized, or plus-minus polarized. When you project these photons here on an entangled state, the ones here are entangled, which shows that there are significant correlations in all three bases. When you project them onto individual states here, then you see that there are only correlations in one base and not in the others. So I like to say that this tells us that the events which are recorded here, they are really fundamental. They are more fundamental reality than the quantum states which can be then used to explain them. The quantum states are more or less just an expression of our information. I just want, since time passes, I have to skip a number here, you know, skip a number. These OM states have been, I understand, presented by Andrew Forbes already in a nice way. I go beyond this also, it takes too much time. I just want to mention here, what's interesting is to go to these THZ states beyond qubits, you know, Q-trits, three-state system. So you have three photons which have each one three states, 0, 1, and 2. And this is clearly has increased information capacity. It allows new conceptual tests of local realism versus quantum mechanics, error correction. There have been proposals that this would be interesting for error correction and so on. But how to do it? How to do it? This is not very, as long as you have only sources for pairs. I remind you for the standard GHS case, you have two sources and you simply mix it or superpose the photons from each source on a polarized beam splitter. You get an entangled state under the condition that you get at each of the four detectors clicks. So this click illuminates the red correlations, which should not be present in the GHZ state. Now, beyond qubits is an interesting question, and you didn't come up with a good solution by such thinking about it. So Mario Kren in my group wrote a computer program called Melvin, which is very intelligent. It automatically searches for solutions given certain inputs. You know, it's given certain inputs, you know, like spiral face plates, beam splitters, and what you name it, what you want. And then try, and it's also given a state which we want to realize. And then in iterative machine learning kind of process, it improves its situation and so on, it produces solutions which do the job, but which are intuitively very difficult to understand. So this is quite interesting. These are solutions which a human would I claim never have found. I just show you the solution here for Melvin. The state produced is this one, two. These are now the number of orbital angular momentum quantum number, as mentioned in the talk of Andrew Forbes. So you have 2, 0, 0, and so on. This is GHZ state for three photons in three dimensions. Now we have two pairs. We have a high brightness 4-photon source, which produces a state which is a superposition entangled state between two photons in three dimensions. And then this device with a multiport, you see, is a rather complicated setup altogether. But it's the generalization in the end of the polarizing beam splitter. Very general, very much generalization. And you get out you can delete the unwanted correlations. So this was performed a while ago in my group. I should go into details. This is a similar experiment we did together with our Chinese friends in 2019, where we teleport Q-trits, not two state systems, but three state systems. This is very interesting. It's absolutely not a trivial extension of the standard situation. But I want to go on because I'm about to finish, I suppose. Maybe I can briefly explain the beautiful little experiment, which was an experiment challenging local realism with human choices. It was an international collaboration. PhD students was Carlos Abelan. It's by coincidence that in alphabetic order, he really did much of the work in the group of Morgan Mitchell, many labs. And the idea simply was to do a Bell test where people had produced random number generators on their mobile devices. And these random number, these results are then sent into cloud infrastructure and distributed to experiments all over the globe. So 12 laboratories on 5 continents, 100,000 human participants, and so on. And actually, it turns out that the random numbers produced by people, they have one interesting deviation from good random numbers, namely that people tend too often change from 0 to 1, from 0 to 1, 1 to 0. But otherwise, the distributions are quite. So people think it has to look more random than what is required. Now, this is a graph, and here clearly we had a polarization. Now, what can be done in these experiments further? We can go out to space, we can have humans doing these experiments and so on. Just two or three more slides on the interpretation, on the measurement problem and so on. I remind you of this quotation by Bohr in 1948. He said, however far the quantum phenomena transcend the scope of classical physical explanation, the account of all evidence must be expressed in classical terms. So we can only talk in classical terms about the results, and the point is now that it is operationally impossible to separate reality from the information about reality. The two are intrinsically connected, and this to me is an important hint for the future. The quantum state from that viewpoint is just a representation of information about classical results, so the classical apparatus, and the only device is to calculate probabilities for future results, which are also features for classical apparatus. And conceptually, fundamentally, philosophically, there's no need for more. The explanation doesn't have to explain more than that. That is enough. And I conclude with this famous quote by Heisenberg. He said, the act of recording, namely the measurement, is not a physical, but rather, so to say, a mathematical process. With a sudden change of our knowledge, also the mathematical representation of our knowledge undergoes, of course, a certain change. So this is no statement that the measurement process is something physically going on. This is quite interesting. Okay? I just conclude with this quotation by Isidore Abi. There was a conference in 1985 for celebrating Niels Bohr. I was there as a young postdoc, you know, and he said, I think we are missing a very basic point. The next generation, when they found it, will knock on their heads and say, how could they have missed it? With that, I thank you very much for your attention. And I'm ready for questions.
Yeah, thank you very much, Anton. So we are open for the questions. Any questions? Okay, till now, I have some. I want to hear your opinion about two things. First of all, could you maybe give some details of recent experiment with this, space transfer of entanglement between China and Austria? Could you comment somehow and experiment?
I should be careful here. It was not a transfer of entanglement between China and Austria. It was a cryptography experiment based on a Bennett-Passar scheme.
That's right. But also they report, I mean, Chinese colleagues report some results about Eker protocol. They distributed keys using E91 protocol.
That's correct. This was not between China and Austria. So we were not part of that experiment. It was a distribution to two ground stations, separated, I think, by 1,200 kilometers apart. And I understand that China built telescopes specifically for that experiment, which is where one of them is at an altitude, I understand, of 5,000 meters because of the atmosphere and so on.
Okay, because I know they had some troubles with passing photons and receiving photons for these long distances. Okay, that's
the big challenge. I mean, the big challenge is to build large enough telescopes, and this is just classical optics.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Just the ray optics of classical optics, whether your telescopes are big enough to receive and send. You know, this is a challenge. In the experiments which we did, the telescopes have the communication experiments, the telescopes have a typical diameter of 1 meter. That is enough to establish keys.
Yeah. Okay. Well, and another, just maybe brief comment, because a couple of days ago we arranged a round table related to the problem of the quantum computer building. So just your opinion. Do you think it is possible to create quantum computer in nearest future? Yes or not, or some comments maybe?
Well, I understand that small quantum computers exist already.
Yeah.
But small ones for very specialized purposes and so on. I find the challenges to really meet the requirements to build a big enough, you know, a CPU with enough qubits and so on. I think we might understand the challenges. I'm not sure. I would say that this is really open how fast it can be and what can happen. And I want to say something very positive in that respect. I think it is really an important challenge, and I believe that all possibilities to realize that should be followed. So it's too early to say whether the superconducting scheme is better or whether the ion scheme is better, or even the photonic scheme, which is pursued by some groups in the world. They should all be pursued, because we don't know where it will go on, and that there can be surprises.
Okay, thanks. So maybe, okay, one question from the audience.
Yes, it might seem a strange question. At some of the first your slide, you mentioned a new era of quantum information, and there you mentioned quantum communication and quantum cryptography. I thought they are synonyms. I mean, is there a quantum communication that is not quantum cryptography? Is there something separate? Can you clarify, please?
Well, yes. I mean, we talk about quantum cryptography. Certainly, is the application. But you know, with the developments going on, we could even think of having just communication with qubits. You know, if our goal is, I don't know how many you need. It's to transfer 1 bit of information. Mm-hmm. I don't know what the status now is, how many photons you need. I don't want to give a number. I looked it up a while ago. But this is a trend which goes down. There's a clear trend that the number of photons used per bit is going down for many reasons, both in computers and in communication. And even in communication inside computers, you know, inside computers, you want to go smaller and smaller. And at some day, this will reach the single quantum level. And it need not be cryptography.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other questions?
What experiment you think is the most important for testing quantum mechanics foundations?
If I would know that, I would not tell you, because I would do it, you know. No, just a joke. What is very important now are the developments happening in with macroscopic systems, with larger and larger systems. This, I think, is quite important. We all know what will happen. I should say the quantum foundations, I expect the quantum foundation to survive every test in the future. This is really my feeling. I'm really convinced of that. But like the early experiments which I mentioned, they changed the minds of people. You know, the early experiments, the foundational experiments which I mentioned, the first entanglement experiments and all this, and they changed the mind of people to that this is not something abstract, but you can have it in the laboratory. And I claim that this really opened up the road to quantum computation and so on. And so the question is, what will open up the minds of people more? I think the road towards gravitational is important. Then I think the road in Bell tests to have even more independent sources of randomness is important. And I would also say that these new developments of checking, there was a talk at this conference, I realized, of checking the relationship between Bell tests the tests with three state systems. Copy-Specker. Correlations. But this is very interesting. Not so much because anyone believes in these hidden properties, but because it tells us about the necessary fundamental properties that theory must have. And these are quite interesting. Again, we can't predict what will happen, but to have the result is different from having it just on paper. But I just talk about fundamentals, not about applications.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. So if there is no questions, so Anton, let us wish you good health and good luck. Yeah, and see you somewhere. Bye bye. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye bye. All the best. All the best. Yeah.